Be here. So we're Matternet. We got started almost 2.5 years ago now at a place down the road called Singularity University at NASA Ames. And this is a place where people go spend the summer there, and it's typically a very diverse group, something like 80 people from 35 plus countries. And we try to see where technology is going and how can we build systems that can solve humanity's grand challenges. And what we want to do is, this needs to be here, I guess. Yeah, so we're thinking of figuring out another way to do transportation at the local level. When we first launched Matternet, someone tweeted that it's Mother Teresa meeting the Jetsons. So what we're talking about is basically networks of unmanned aerial vehicles that are operating autonomously to solve last mile delivery or any sort of transportation, peer-to-peer transportation problems that occur at the local level. And you know, for a long time we considered this to be the future of humanity. And that's something that we wanted to basically rethink about at Matternet. If you think about it, a road is a pretty old invention. It's, you know, close to 5 millennia ago, we started fixing wheels on carts and then developing sort of smooth surfaces to be, you know, gliding those, you know, wheels on. And wave over wave of technological sort of civilization added more sophistication to the system, and we ended up with this. And, you know, currently in the US, we have more than 4 million miles of roads. And you know, everybody assumes that this is really how the world ought to work. There's a lot of pressure to try and rethink this. I was last year at the International Transport Forum in Germany. This is a place where people basically meet at the ministerial level, come together to think, you know, of transportation and the whole ecosystem of transportation. And you know, there's a big problem around how do you basically maintain this at a very high level. And then, you know, there's all this other part of the world where this happens, where you don't have roads and you need to develop them. So there's 1 billion people in the world today that do not have access to all-season roads. So typically in the rainy season, that may last 2 or 3 months in some places, people are totally disconnected. It's impossible to get medicine to them. It's impossible for them to participate in the economy because they don't have a way to get their products to market reliably. This is, in our opinion, the thing that drives global extreme poverty at the global level today. So, you know, 2/3 of the people living under extreme poverty are, you know, facing this situation. So, if we really wanted to change, you know, how the world works, we ought to figure out a way to solve this problem. And we think that this is the way. So, initially for small payloads, we believe that we can start using unmanned aerial vehicles to transport medicine and other critical goods in places that don't have road infrastructure. And then again, you know, you switch on the other sort of ends of the spectrum, or the other end of the range, not where you don't have, you know, concentrated populations, but in the urban sort of condensed environments. We are already an urban civilization. More than half of the Earth's population lives in cities today, and more than 500 million of us live in 27 megacities. These are cities with more than 10 million inhabitants. And in those places, congestion is a huge problem. We're wasting every year billions of hours on the road, wasting in traffic. We're wasting billions of liters of fuel. Energy is wasted on the road. So we think that it makes sense in those places to start thinking about, you know, how can we lift some of that traffic off the road. Our vision is to basically create the technologies that will allow us to do peer-to-peer transportation of small goods initially in all sorts of places, starting in places in the developing world that don't have any alternatives today, and the need is great. You can actually be saving lives when you do this sort of thing. And over time, bringing here this here to the US and, you know, here in the developing world, in our cities and megacities, and help make them more livable, help reduce carbon dioxide emissions, help conserve energy and so forth. So the way that we think about what we're creating is a network, right? So We want it to be a next generation transportation network that is enabled by this new technology. And you know, we're kidding, you know, when we're sort of brainstorming in the team that the only thing that could really disrupt this type of network would be teleportation. So when you don't have the need to transport physically any matter in space. But you know, what's interesting to us about this is that it shares a lot of the properties of the internet. So you suddenly have a system that is decentralized, it's peer-to-peer, it's dematerialized, it's very, very adaptable, it's bidirectional, and once you start understanding the implications of this, it can be revolutionary about how we do things. I giggled at your Zamazon thing when I saw it in the website. We spend a lot of time talking about these types of models. You know, if eBay sort of democratized commerce, what could a system like this do, you know, to complement? So we pretty much see the Matternet as like a, you know, the thing that really complements the internet. Because right now we have these amazing technologies that allow information to spread. And, you know, that happens. It's decentralized. You know, anybody can be part of the internet, can be sort of a knowledge generator. But when you need, you actually need atoms to move, we're still sort of stuck in the old, in the old ways and in the past century. So that's the thing we're trying to change. Let me show you where this sort of starts. This is one of the missions we've done last year in Haiti. Here we are basically doing a medical delivery. It's a 2 kilogram payload, and here we're delivering something in a camp that was set up after the 2010 earthquake in Haiti. So that vehicle right here is like a mostly off the shelf vehicle in this pilot. It's able to transport about 2 kilograms in about 10 kilometers over 15 minutes. And it's the cost of it's about $3,000. So, you know, we have this big idea that it starts from here, and we really would like to see that type of system doing for transportation what mobile did for communications. So, you know, who would have imagined like 30 years ago when, you know, you saw a sort of Wall Street executive with this clunky, you know, big chunky sort of mobile phones that was like a suitcase, like, right, that this type of technology, you know, would be the engine of growth of a country like Kenya. And, you know, whole countries would never lay copper lights on the ground. They would jump onto the next paradigm. We believe this is possible with this type of technology. And I'm getting sort of super excited about, you know, to me, unmanned aerial vehicles, for the reasons that Tim mentioned before, you know, sensors, computation, is, you know, an amazing thing. I think it's the biggest invention in transportation technology since the internal combustion engine. So I purposefully, I dislike the word, you know, drones. It's a very loaded word. It means, I think, something else. For me, when I see those things, I see vehicles. And of course, you know, it speaks, I'm biased. I'm looking at them as transportation vehicles. I'm hoping to be able to transport with them goods and eventually people. And I think that the way that we can get really mass aerial transportation happening at the people's level will be, you know, with fully autonomous vehicles like this. I think it's going to be a big deal. I think we're just seeing the tip of the iceberg right now. It's interesting that this type of technology has captured the imagination of the world and everybody's talking about it. I believe that we are on the hype curve of this technology, as we are typically with all sorts of new technologies, right? So we see it with biotechnology, we see it with 3D printing. We believe that technology can do more than it can actually do at scale. And you know, we're spending a lot of time thinking, okay, how can we really scale this system? How can we make it work reliably and really become a new tool that is a backbone for our civilization? And when we're thinking about, you know, our system, we've designed a system that allows us to deal with the shortfalls of the technologies, as we see them today. So, you know, we have flying vehicles, and we only fly between landing stations that are fixed on the ground. These are locations that are pre-registered, so the air paths between them are always known. And in that way, we keep the airspace tidy. We only fly in a certain segment of the airspace. We keep segregated from all other traffic. There is a new, you know, there's like at least three different entities that are working now under the umbrella of the FAA to figure this out. Somebody was asking before, how will this thing scale? People are thinking about this a lot, and there are some solutions on the table and some technologies that will actually enable us to do that. So, you know, it's flying vehicles, landing stations, and the third component is what we call Matternet OS, which is the operating system that manages the network. And, you know, how do you manage a fleet of vehicles? You know, we've done a model for LA, you know, if we were to transport e-commerce things, goods, we would basically need something like 2,000 vehicles every day doing deliveries, thousands of deliveries, hundreds of thousands of deliveries a day. How do you keep, you know, the fleet? You monitor the fleet to make sure that you have safe vehicles. How do you position the fleet where you need them? The Uber time of that problem. It's super interesting. And what's the driving force behind it, I believe, is that, and the reason why it's inevitable, it's going to happen, you know, in some part of the world, and it could be, you know, that it happens in China first, or it happens here first, or it happens, you know, in Kenya first, is because the cost is super low. You don't have, you are basically automating something that is a labor-intensive activity today, and you're doing it with a vehicle that is working very well for the disaggregated delivery problem, what is called last mile delivery, when you don't have the ability to ship like tons of stuff together, but you only need to ship like a couple of kilograms at a time. You have a very lightweight vehicle transporting a lightweight load, and that manifests itself in like the cost of energy that you expend in that flight. And for me, that was like the biggest realization. When we started off the project, like a couple of weeks in, everybody was saying to us, guys, you must be crazy. It can't be cost efficient to fly. And when we saw the equations and we actually saw that the physics are, you know, behind this idea, we thought that it's actually inevitable. So, you know, internet for atoms, Matternet. We believe it's going to be automated, working in the background 24/7. We wanted to make it as easy to send a pair of sunglasses or, you know, something, you know, cookies from my mother to me, like as easy as I can get an email today. We believe that, you know, it also gives us an opportunity to maintain the virgin part of the world, the virgin part of this planet, pretty, you know, at the closest state to where it is today. So I don't think we have to, you know, follow the paradigms of the West. The new world, as I see it, you know, which is like right now, according to the UN, South Africa and Southeast Asia are the fastest growing regions in the world. And I believe these regions have a chance to create a better environment for themselves than we've done it here. Thank you. Yeah, so first of all, it's possible to do it. We know that, you know, you can scale.
It's practical and has somebody done it?
Yes, people have done it, of course. You have to put more constraints into the question to make it. So, okay, the question is 100 kilometers, 100 kilograms, has somebody done it? The military is doing it routinely and with much larger payloads.
With this type of vehicle?
If you want it to be an electric vehicle, yes, you can scale the vehicle. I don't know of any electric vehicle that is doing it today, but it's possible to design it. I don't know if Tim agrees with that, but I believe it's possible to scale the technology to this level, according to our estimate. Now, when we look at this problem and we started off thinking, okay, we'll ride the curve of increasing payload capacity and increasing range over time. It will depend on how efficient the vehicle is. These guys fly like helicopters. It's much more efficient to hover, to glide, basically. So, but you need vertical takeoff and landing, so you end up with a hybrid vehicle. You know, and we'll figure ways to do this. We, as Matternet, and we as an industry, will figure out designs that work for that. What's interesting to me is how you can keep the cost of the vehicle very, very low. This is where you have the ability to create networks. And a network is a super interesting idea in order to create something that's super reliable at a very low cost. So, you know, to me, it's much more interesting, an interesting technological goal to go for a long range and keep the payload small. So I'm interested more to a 2 kilogram or even 1 kilogram payload capacity, 500 kilometers, rather than, you know, a big payload capacity and, you know, smaller range.
You talked about infrastructure. I mean, clearly this doesn't need roads, but it needs some sort of infrastructure.
Yeah.
Can you say a little more about what's required there?
Of course. So there is a way to solve communications without relying to telephony extensively by having a mesh network between the vehicles and the stations. But it's good if you have telephony, cellular telephony, and I think that's a bit of infrastructure that's good to have. The next big question is, how do you power these guys? So, you know, the ideal answer there is solar. Are we able to do solar today? Probably not in the places that we want to go first. And there are many design considerations. How do you guard the equipment that you put on the ground, right? So in those cases, generators in some remote places are the answer. I think these are the bigger ones. And in my mind, the power one is the most challenging. Then you need to basically, people don't realize this, or maybe they do, but we don't talk about it a lot, is that you need to operate within a framework of legality. So people ask me, you know, will people shoot these guys down? It's hard to shoot it down when it moves at, like, you know, 50 kilometers an hour at 400 feet. But there is a vulnerable part of the mission when it's landing. And our strategy for that is to basically work with organizations initially that are respected in the places they operate. And they basically guarantee the safety of that equipment. But you need some sort of, you know, social structure that enables you to do that. So we cannot just go in a conflict zone and do it. There needs to be something that people, you know, there is like a sort of a structure that allows you to go in and do it.
Social acceptance.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. Please, yeah.
I have actually an answer perhaps to your previous question. Volocopter VC200 is a 18-blade electric helicopter that just been tested in Germany.
Sorry, what's the name of it?
A Volocopter VC200.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
My question is,
yeah, there are other companies working on it, but, you know, how do you answer this question, right? It's possible to fly any of those vehicles in one's backyard. The question is, you know, is it a product? Can you actually use it?
So
can you use it at scale?
My question is actually, yeah, how to, what is the limit, or how to make the $6,000 drone cost $100? What are the limits?
Is that interesting? Why would you do that?
I think the cost is one of the major barriers to deploying these on mass scale, right? If it's a $6,000 machine, you're less likely to have thousands of them flying around versus $100.
Well, it depends on its lifetime and how many trips it can do per day and so forth. So, you know, if you saw the numbers there, so this is basically based on a $3,000 vehicle cost that is able to do a number of trips a day. And the cost of the vehicle is amortized over its lifetime, and the projected lifetime on this vehicle is three years. So in that, you know, if you're able to hit, so the short answer to the question, or the bottom line, I guess, is that reliability is the most important thing, and safety is the most important thing, right? So you can talk about making these things disposable, not caring about, you know, when they fall out of the sky, but I think when you want to create a tool, the best way to create it is, you know, make it a dependable tool. So, you know, the thing that we're driving towards, and I think the industry needs to drive towards, and, you know, that will basically unlock the applications, is that, you know, when I have one of those, I know that most of the times it won't crash. Otherwise, you know, I can't depend on it. I'll wait until it gets more mature to be able to use it. The same is in those, in this type of situation, and crashing here costs more, you know. Yeah, but you would pay for a car.
Yeah, current delivery systems are a lot more expensive than 6,000 miles.
Yeah, yeah. So I'll give you a sense of scale. We've done a case study. We haven't executed a pilot there, but we've done a case study for a tiny country in South Africa called Lesotho. They have an intense AIDS epidemic, and we said, you know, they cannot. It's a very mountainous country, huge transportation problem, no roads. Organizations are working there to try and solve the problem, and they're hidden by lack of transportation. And we said, okay, let's see how much it will cost to set up a network. It turned out that in order to cover a district that is like 1.5 times the size of Manhattan, the cost of setting up a network and solving the whole problem there would be less than $1 million. Like $1 million, according to the World Bank, is the cost of laying 2 kilometers, one lane road. So when you compare it to any, I mean, that's the power of a new paradigm, right? I mean, new paradigms do that. They just disrupt the status quo with economics in a way that you haven't imagined possible. Even if we are like an order of magnitude away, that people challenge us that we're super optimistic, yes, okay. You know, it's a matter of, you know, time projection, like time horizon. If we're like a matter order of magnitude out, we still you know, better by orders of magnitude by the old paradigm.
So bottom line, cost is not a problem.
So it's, you have to marry cost targets, reliability, and safety. That will drive public acceptance, and it will drive regulatory approvals, in my mind. And that then will basically allow the industry to adopt it.
Isn't the bottom line that your cost over 3 years is $3 to $6 per day? And so as long as you're doing something with it that's worth $3 to $6 per day with you, to you, then cost isn't important? Not that like cost is no object, but that it's actually not that expensive now, is what you're saying.
Yeah. Yeah, so, yeah, I mean, the so cost is, again, I mean, for me, everything is basically flowing out of how reliable the vehicle is. Because, you know, to hit those costs, you need to have a vehicle that will be able to basically run for 8 hours a day. In that model, is about 10 deliveries a day, so it's not much, for 3 years. And that's a vehicle that doesn't exist today. Right, so the reliability is not there yet. We're trying to create it, other people are doing it too. I think this is where the industry, that's the bet that has to be won.
But what if you turn it so it is consumer owned, not company owned?
Yeah, that's the vision. Yeah.
Amazon having a million of those.
Yeah.
I have my own.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm on a plan like I am with this.
Yeah.
And I only do short
deliveries,
or I do longer deliveries.
Yeah. Exactly.
Or
yeah.
I
so,
my own drone and I decide where that goes.
Yeah, you just captured our vision.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll do one final question and then.
George.
I'm just curious how you see yourself in comparison to AT&T and/or UPS and/or neither.
We see ourselves in comparison to the handset manufacturers. So we say, I mean, there's some interesting sort of business models that you can think about. How, you know, who pays for this, and how do you sell people packages of usage, right? Like AT&T and Verizon do. We would like to be on, you know, the guys that make the technology and make it available, and then, you know, there's going to be business models on top of it. There is an X factor, which, you know, people say that it's not going to happen, but I'm not exactly sure it's not going to happen. Will use of the airspace remain free? If this thing is monetizable, that I think it is, you know, will the, you know, the governments around the world want to keep it open and free for all to use like it is today? Maybe yes, maybe no. Maybe they will end up sort of auctioning the spectrum, the air spectrum, I guess, the airspace, in the same way they auction the spectrum. Who knows? Yeah, but it's interesting to see. I mean, I think it's the birth of a new industry. I consider myself sort of, you know, lucky to be in it somehow, because, you know, I envy the guys that were around where a computer was sort of created, and now we have a similar thing. And I think what's true of this industry, as it's true of any industries, is that you can't really imagine what's going to happen. We can only sort of extrapolate from existing experience how we can use those systems to, you know, mimic the existing systems. But this is not what new paradigms do. I mean, they start from that and they go way further and they create all sorts of interesting things.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much.
Thanks.